go to the next one. See, I have to yet to solve previous year questions. So I mean, some of the unique question that is coming in my mind, I'm doing that first. Okay, so because you need to also recall some concepts. Anyways, so here is one cylinder. Okay, there is this cylinder of mass m and radius r. Okay, mass m and radius r, there is this cylinder, and there is this string which is attached to two masses. Let's say this is mass m1 and this is mass m2. Okay, and there is no slipping between the string and this pulley. This pulley is actually rotating. Let's say m1 is going down. Okay, so this pulley is actually rotating like this. Okay, and there is no slipping. You need to find out what is the acceleration of m1 and m2. Is acceleration of m1 same as acceleration of m2, or they are different?
So they have to be same.
They have to be same because it is constrained to move like that. There is no.
So what is the moment of inertia here?
I said this is a cylinder, solid cylinder.
Okay.
See, the what I asked is acceleration of m1 and m2, and angular acceleration is related to that.
So I'm getting m1g minus m2g by m1 plus m2 plus m by 2.
Okay, let me slowly start solving this question. Meanwhile, all of you, those who have not got it, please keep on trying. Does the tension need to be same? Tension need not be same. Okay, we have been using this assumption that it is same string, so same tension. Okay, but that assumption is true only when it is frictionless cylinder and there is the string is massless, the cylinder is frictionless, the pulley is massless. So all kinds of assumption we are making. That is why we have same string, same tension. But when it comes to problems like these, you cannot assume both the tensions to be same. Okay, the reason is this. I'll first draw all the forces, and then let me draw the free body diagram of a cylinder. The reason is this: there is this force due to this joint. Let's say this is T naught force, and here you have T. Let's say this is T2, this is T2, and this one is T1. Okay, so torque due to T1 and T2 on the cylinder will be what? T1 R minus T2 R, because the perpendicular distance of T1 is R and of the T2 is again R only, right? So but then T1 is trying to rotate this way, but T2 is trying to rotate in opposite way. So there has to be a subtraction. So this is the net torque for the cylinder. Okay. And if net torque is zero, the angular acceleration should be zero. Okay. So if cylinder has to rotate, one tension should be more than the other tension. Okay. That is the reason why tension is not same if cylinder has a mass and it is rotating, as in it has angular acceleration. This is equal to I alpha. Okay, this is one equation. Okay, because the torque due to the T naught is zero. T naught is passing through the center of mass. So the torque due to this force, T naught force, is zero. All right. So let me write second law of motion equation for M1. So I'll get M1G minus T1 is equal to m1a. Okay, and for m2 we have t2 minus m2g is equal to m2 into a. Now how many variables we have? T1, t2, alpha, then A. So we have four variables, but only three equations. Okay. So that is the reason why you need another relation that is actually a constraint relation. That is a no slipping relation. Okay. For example, this point on the cylinder, let's say there is this point which is on the cylinder, it will move with the same acceleration as the string is moving. So string's acceleration at this point is same as the cylinder's acceleration at that point. Okay, so the cylinder's acceleration at this point is what? Alpha into r. Okay, so about this point, if you see what is the acceleration of this point with respect to this, this point is moving in a circle. So it is alpha into r, the acceleration of this point. And this has to be equal to the acceleration of the string, which is A. Okay. So you have now four equations, and moment of inertia, you know, is capital M r square by 2. So all you have to do is just solve these and you'll get the answer. Okay. Any doubt with respect to this?
No, sir.
Okay. One more. Suppose you have a rod lying on a horizontal table. Okay. It is a frictionless table. This rod is lying on a frictionless table. Then what else is given is, you know, the mass is M and the length of this rod is L. Okay. Then this small mass comes from this side. Let's say the mass is small m, the velocity is v naught. Okay, so everything is horizontal, you know. So when this mass hits the rod, this mass comes to rest. Okay, and then rod moves, leaving this small m on the table itself. Okay, so you need to find what is the velocity of center of mass for this rod after this small m hits the rod. Vcm is what? Okay, tell me one thing. Can I conserve linear momentum over here? Horizontally? In this direction, can I conserve linear momentum?
So there are no external forces, so...
Yes, I can conserve the linear momentum. See, many a times we are very conscious about the thing that, you know, since it is a bigger object, we cannot conserve linear momentum or something which is valid only for the smaller blocks that we have learned in laws of motion chapter. But that is not true. Okay, whatever you have learned before this chapter, everything is true. Okay, so you can use conservation of linear momentum over here. Okay, but the problem is that the rod's velocity at all the points, they are different. So which velocity will you take to write the linear momentum of the rod? Mass into velocity, which you have to write, because velocity is different at different points after it, after the mass hits the block, after the mass hit the rod. So the logical choice is V center of mass. Okay, so there's a proof also for that, but we'll not go there. So, you know, initial momentum before this mass hits the rod is what for the system is M into V naught. Okay. And after this hits the rod, the momentum of the rod becomes M into VCM, and momentum of this small m becomes zero. And before the momentum of the capital M was zero. So you can equate these two, and you'll get velocity of center of mass to be equal to small m by capital M times V naught. Fine. Now you need to also find out the angular velocity of the rod. This rod will not just move straight, right? This rod will rotate also. Yes or no? So find out what is the angular velocity of this rod. Velocity be the velocity of the tip of the rod. No, Vaishnavi, that's not correct. When we write a linear momentum of a rigid body, we take mass into velocity of center of mass. Sundar, that's not correct. That would have been correct if one end of the rod is fixed and the other end is moving with velocity v. Then angular velocity you can say is v by l. But here that is not correct. Okay, Kushal is giving an answer. M v naught l by 2. Others?
So I'm getting whole root of 12 into v naught square by l square into 1 minus m cube, small m cube by m square, big m square.
Oh, acha. First tell me, which concept should you use here? You're trying to find angular velocity. So in which concept the angular velocity comes in the expression, or which equation that angular velocity term comes in?
Work energy.
That work energy theorem is one. Now, are you assuming here that energy is conserved before and after? Energy may not be conserved. Due to the collision, some energy might have got lost. Right? So you cannot conserve energy before the collision and after the collision, because during the collision, energy is lost. Okay, so here the more appropriate expression, other than work energy theorem, the only expression left with you to use where angular velocity comes in the equation is conservation of angular momentum. Okay, so that is what we'll be using here. Okay, now about which axis should I use conservation of angular momentum? About an axis about which net external torque is zero. Okay, now external to what? External to the rod, external to the small m, or external to both small m plus capital M? External to both. Okay, so whatever is the force between small m and capital M, that is internal force. Because of that, there is no external torque that is getting produced, because I'm assuming my system to be small m and capital M together. Okay, so I can choose any axis to write moment of I can use any axis to write the angular momentum of the rod. Okay, but if I use any other axis other than center of mass axis to write angular momentum of the rod, then the expression is bigger, you know, the expression is R cross M into VCM plus ICM into omega. This R is a distance of the axis from the center of mass. Okay, so you have to take perpendicular distance of the axis from the center of mass. So unnecessary, why to go beyond the center of mass? So we'll try to find angular momentum about the center of mass axis itself, so that this R is zero. Okay, hence we can say that angular momentum of small m initially plus angular momentum of capital M initially, this is initial, should be equal to angular momentum of small m plus angular momentum of capital M finally. Okay, now what is the angular momentum of small m about this axis before the collision? It is a particle, right? It's a particle whose perpendicular distance is what? This is a perpendicular distance of its velocity from the axis, right? Which is what? L by 2. Okay, so its angular momentum of this particle before the collision is L by 2 into m into v naught. All of you following me?
Yes, sir.
Plus angular momentum of the capital M is zero before the collision. The rod is not doing anything. Plus angular momentum of small m after the collision is zero. It comes to rest after collision. Plus angular momentum of capital M after the collision. After the collision, angular momentum of the capital M is simply ICM into omega. Getting it? Now ICM is what? M into L square by 12 for the rod into omega. Fine. So you will get, this comes to 6 and this is like that. So you'll get omega to be equal to 6 m v naught divided by capital M into L. Okay, so this is the angular velocity. Anyone got this? No one? Anyways, no problem. Just it is good that you are getting to learn these things. But keep in mind when you do it later on, similar question. So just like you are free to use conservation of linear momentum, similarly, you should be very much familiar with conservation of angular momentum also. Any doubts till now? Anyone of you? Any doubts? I use a concept, but I took it as ML square by 3. Purvik, don't do that. Okay, I assume no doubts, so I can move ahead. Okay, so the same question, you need to find out a point on the rod which is at rest immediately after the collision, the point on the rod which is at rest, where it is located. All the points on the rod, they are having different velocities. So which is the point on the rod which is at rest immediately after the collision?
So is it a point at a distance of L by 6 from the center of mass?
Where, left or right?
Left.
Anybody else getting? See, the points on the right, if you look at it, with respect to center, suppose you are taking a point at a distance of R, fine. So let's say this is the point which is at a distance R, okay? So its velocity with respect to center of mass, if this is R, is omega into R, okay? With respect to center of mass, its velocity is omega into R. Then VCM is also in that direction. So total velocity is this plus VCM. Okay. So will this ever go to zero? No, it will not go to zero. But if you look at the left hand side, at the same distance, let us say at a distance of R, omega into R is down. Okay. Because it is rotating like that. Fine. So with respect to center of mass, its velocity will be down, omega R. And also, this is going forward with VCM. Okay, so total velocity on the left hand side at a distance R is omega R minus VCM. Okay, so we have to find out where this becomes zero. All right, so R is nothing but VCM divided by omega. So you have the value of omega, you have the value of VCM. You can just substitute the values. You'll get it as L by 6 from the center towards the left. Okay. Any doubts with respect to this question? Now we can take up, past year questions. If you have any doubts on this, please quickly raise it. Okay. Supposed to conserve angular momentum from the point where VCM is equal to omega R. See, Shweta, you can conserve angular momentum about any point. Because there is no external torque on the system about any horizontal axis. Fine. Why we are taking center of the rod? You're taking center of the rod so that you can write angular momentum of a rod simply as ICM into omega. If you are writing the angular momentum about any other axis for the rod, then it will not be equal to I into omega about that axis. Okay, so it will be m in r cross m vcm, r is a perpendicular distance of that axis from the center of mass, into m into vcm plus icm omega. So unnecessary an extra term is coming. Okay, so that is the reason why we are conserving angular momentum about the center of mass axis. Yes, moment of inertia will change. That is why to compensate that there is another term r cross mv. So you will end of the day when you add up these two, you get the same thing.